Let's look at some more examples. This graph is given to us and we're supposed to find the vertex of the graph. So the vertex, of course, in this case is right here, which happens to be a maximum point for this graph because it opens downwards. So I see the x-coordinate is 2 and the y-coordinate is negative 2. So all they're asking for is the ordered pair 2, negative 2. And I'm sorry, I said a minimum. This is actually a maximum because the I think I said a minimum, but I meant a maximum. It's opening downward, so it has a maximum. And the maximum is actually the y value, which in this case is negative 2. All other y values are smaller than negative 2. That's the biggest it ever gets. What is the axis of symmetry? We know that's a mirror, basically, that's right in the middle, and the parabola is symmetric about that line. So whatever happens to the right of the parabola, it also happens to the left of the parabola. Has the mirror image on both sides. And it's a vertical line, so it has to be x equals some number, and I see it goes right through the x-coordinate 2, which is, remember, the same as the x-coordinate of the vertex. So the axis of symmetry is the equation x equals 2. The other thing they want us to do is evaluate these two outputs from the inputs given. So remember, 2 is the input, or the x value, and we're looking for the output or the y value. And we're supposed to get this from the graph because we don't have an equation given to put it into. So I'm given the input, I need the output. So the input is the x, I go stand at the x coordinate of 2, and when I stand at the x coordinate of 2, the y coordinate is right here because I have that ordered pair which is the same as the vertex, 2, negative 2. So input is 2 and output is negative 2. Let's go and do the same thing for the input x3 and see what the output or the y may be. In that case, we need to clean up what we have going on our graph so we can see better. So let's go to the x-coordinate of 3, which is right here. And when I stand at the x-coordinate of 3, all I got to do is go down to my graph, and my graph goes through that ordered pair, which is 3 for the x and negative 3 for the y. So if the input is 3, the output y is negative 3 in this case. In this example, it says do the following for f of x. Identify the vertex and axis of symmetry on this graph, and then graph it, so we've got to graph it on the right, and then evaluate these two. And those could easily be evaluated because the equation is already given. We put the input and it gives us the output, so we don't necessarily need the graph. We can just get those from the function, but we'll go through it in order. So the function I have is f of x equals x squared minus 2, and our notes earlier said that that's basically the x squared function shifted down 2 because of this negative 2 that it has. So from the previous notes, we know that it's just shifted down 2 units. So I could go and do a quick sketch and say, oh, it's a parabola that opens up, by the way, because the leading coefficient is a positive 1, and it goes through 0, negative 2, so something like that really quickly. I can do a sketch. But if I want to be more accurate, I can also do an xy chart if I want to, but the sketch helps me because I already have an idea of what the graph looks like. So I did a quick xy chart. I put in a couple of x's and an x right smack in the middle, 0, and then it gave me the outputs. I got positive y values, and for this one, when x was 0, I got a negative 2 for my y value. So there's a rough sketch, parabola opening up, of what the graph of this function looks like. And so the vertex clearly is 0, negative 2. That's the vertex in this graph. And the axis of symmetry is always going to be the x-coordinate of the vertex. So x equals 0 is the vertical line, which is actually just the y-axis. That's the mirror for this parabola. Now part C says, so we got the graph. Part C says, evaluate f of negative 5 and f of 3. Well, I'm just going to go back to this function. Why even bother going to the graph? I input negative 5 if I have the equation. That's 25 minus 2, which is 23. And if I input 3 in my function, I already actually have that up here, don't I? That's going to give me 9 minus 2, which is 7. So input negative 5, output 23, input 3, output 7. Negative 5, 23, 3, and 7 are my ordered pairs that will appear on this graph. Do the following for this graph. We're going to, for this equation, graph it, identify the vertex and the axis of symmetry, and then again give me the f of y value corresponding to these two x values, so f of negative 2 and f of negative 3. So just some things to notice from the notes. This negative means the parabola is going to open down, and this plus 4 inside the binomial squared, remember, means shift left 4 units. So before I even go to the graph, I know that my original parabola would always go through the origin, but now it's shifted 1, 2, 3, 4 to the left, and it opens down. So I should have a rough sketch of like that, but I can go get some more accurate ordered pairs. So because I had a hunch that this parabola was lifted, shifted left 4, I'm going to go ahead and put some appropriate x-coordinates. When I put negative 6, I get a negative 4. Remember, this negative keeps going until the very end and drops in front of the number. When I put a negative 4, I get 0 when I do the math in here. When I put a negative 2 again, I get negative 4. And when I put a 0, I get a negative 16. So let's go do a more accurate sketch. So there's my graph. And then the last ordered pair, which is the y-intercept, 0, negative 16, is going to be way down here when this graph continues to go down. So we did the graph, opening down parabola, identified the vertex and the axis of symmetry. Well, the vertex is right here, we can see. So the vertex is going to be negative 4, 0. And then the axis of symmetry, always remember, goes right through the vertex. So it's going to have x equals negative 4 as the equation of the axis of symmetry. Evaluate f of negative 2 and f of 3. I'm not going to pull them out from the function from the graph, because I don't know if I have it accurate enough. I'm just going to go and find it from the actual functions. So f of negative 2 we actually have already. F of negative 2 has an output of negative 4. Let's go do f of 3. And so when I put 3 in for my function here, I get a 7, negative outside, that squared is negative 49. So if I'm at x equals 3, it's going to be way, way down there since the parabola keeps going down. So use this function to answer the questions. I'm going to take that function, and before I do anything, I'll put it in descending order. And then I'll just put a plus 0 at the end, because I know that's always the y-intercept and it makes it clear for me. Does the graph of f open up or down? Well, since a is negative 2 right here, it opens down. Is the graph wider, narrower, the same as the graph of y equals x squared? Well, based on our notes, if a is bigger than 1, if I ignore the negative part, since a is bigger than 1, it's actually going to be narrower. We called it taller or skinnier. So skinnier, taller, or in this case, narrower, because all the y values get doubled. It's narrower than the graph of y equals x squared. Again, refer back to the lecture notes where we analyzed on the TR calculator how that happens. Part B says, find the axis of symmetry and the vertex. Well, now I gotta go do my equation x equals negative b over 2a to find the vertex. So a is negative 2 and b is 8. So negative 8 over 2a is negative 2. That's negative 8 over negative 4, which gives me a 2. I go put it back in to find the y value. So once I plug this x back into this function or this function, I get an output of 8. So the y value of the vertex is 8 and the x coordinate is 2. That automatically gives me, so we found the vertex, the axis of symmetry is going to have x equals to 2 as its line, the vertical line that has the mirror image on both sides of the parabola. Part C says, find the y-intercept and any x-intercept. So part C, for the y-intercept, remember we make x equal to 0. So when I make x equal to 0 and I input it into my function, I get y equal to 0. So the y-intercept is 0 In other words, this graph goes through 0, 0. An easy way to remember, again, is that that last number, c, is always going to be your y-intercept because the x's will drop. Now, they also set x-intercept. So for the x-intercepts, we automatically make the y 0, which is the f of x part, factor the GCF, set each factor equal to 0 from chapter 5, and pop out your two solutions. So the x-intercept is 0, 0, and 4, 0. Remember, because the y is always 0. Part D tells us to sketch a graph, so we're going to go use all the information. I wrote the vertex I found, the y-intercept, and the two x-intercepts, and I'm going to put it all together here. So I got my vertex, my y-intercept, my two x-intercept, and we know it opens down because the leading coefficient was negative. And there's my overall parabola. A baseball is hit into the air, and its height in feet after t seconds is given by this function, so it's good that they give us the equation already. What is the height of the baseball when it is hit? So right when it is hit, t is 0. Right off the bat, when it's hit, t is 0. So I let t be equal to 0 in my function and see what it spits out. Well, the first pieces look like they just drop out. And I have 2 feet is initially how high the baseball was when it was hit. Part B says, how many seconds does the ball reach and how many seconds its maximum height? So when it says max height, you're basically finding the vertex y-coordinate. Actually, it says after how many seconds, so it's looking for time. So scratch that, I'm not looking for the y-coordinate, that's what the other part is asking. So it says after how many seconds, that's what I'm looking for, does the baseball reach its maximum height? I still have to look for the vertex because that's going to help me reach the maximum of this function. Remember, it's a parabola opening down, so it probably looks something like this. Starting at t equals 0, 2 feet height, and we're looking for when the maximum height occurred. So when we find negative b over 2a, which is the x or the t coordinate in this case, we get b to be 128, so negative 128, 2 times a is negative 16. I evaluate that to be at 4 seconds, basically. That's when it reaches its maximum height, because they asked for when. So that thing right there happens at 4 seconds later. Now part C says determine the maximum height. So in B I was looking for seconds, in C I'm looking for the height. Well, if I'm looking for the height, I must take the time when it occurred to be maximum and put it back in there. So again, now I'm looking for the vertex, but here it was really the x coordinate or the t coordinate. And here it's the y-coordinate because of what it is asking me for. It's asking for the height, so I have to go find the y-coordinate. I got the x-coordinate or the t-coordinate. Let me just go plug it back in. So once I put 4 back into this function for the t-value, it spits out 258. So 258 feet is the maximum height that the ball will ever reach. In other words, that happens at 258 feet. So the ball starts at 2 feet, goes up in the air, reaches a maximum height of 258 at 4 seconds, and then eventually it comes back down and hits the ground. Now we could ask for things like when will it reach 200 feet up in the air? And we could be potentially thinking of it graphically. Well, it's going to reach 200 feet on its way up, and it's going to reach 200 feet on its way down as well. And we could find that just by going and plugging in the y value of 200 for our height and then solving that quadratic equation by moving everything to one side and factoring and seeing what'll happen and what those two t values will be that'll pop up.